Good morning, everyone. It's glad to see you're still all here, still alive, fresh and kicking. So today we discuss, we're done more or less with a more formal, if you wish, part. And today and tomorrow it will be mostly applications, phenomenology, an overview of the things that can be done with Hadron Colliders, but with a focus on QCD. Of course, with the Hadron Collider, as I said at the beginning, we can look for new physics, we can do electroweak physics, we can do certainly flavor physics, but I will just focus on topics that are more directly related, at least today, to QCD. So this is the proton. Those are the three, the three valence quarks inside the proton, and we already discussed this, this picture in which if we start looking inside the proton at shorter and shorter distances, shorter and shorter time scales, of course, pretty much we can find everything we want out of virtual gluons. If we, again, look with an even shorter time scale, we can get top quarks, we can get B quarks, we can get Z bosons, and, you know, if we are even shorter, if we're taking an even smaller, higher resolution out of a top quark pair, we can even create a Higgs boson. So pretty much everything happens in the virtual world inside the proton. And if we want to materialize these phenomena taking place in the virtual world, we just have to add the proper energy to these intermediate virtual systems, so that we can put on shell whatever particle we're interested in. So that we can do with coming in with our proton. We take a gluon from the proton and it just puts on shell the TT-bar system, and we create a TT-bar pair. So here you recognize a glue goes to TT-bar final state, which we discussed shortly at the end of yesterday. If we take a quark or an anti-quark from the proton colliding with this quark from the initial state, that provides the proper energy so that this Z can be put on shell, and therefore we have QQ bar annihilation into a Z. And of course, if we connect a gluon to this gluon, we're putting into the system potentially enough energy so that a Higgs boson can be produced. So what's nice about proton-proton collisions is that really we have access to pretty much every single phenomenon, every single process that you can imagine. In that sense, we have a bit more variety of phenomena than we would have, say, in E plus E minus, because E plus E minus is really driven mostly by electromagnetic processes. So before we get to several of these final states, we have to go through higher order processes. So let me start with, you know, we started our lectures on Monday talking about PDFs. So let me go back to some interesting observables that can be used to learn more about the parton densities. And let me talk about one particular distribution, which is the so-called W rapidity asymmetry. And we start from discussing this in the context of proton-antiproton collisions, and then we do it for proton-proton. So if we want to create a W plus, we can create the W plus by taking a U quark and a D bar quark. Of course, we could be taking the U quark from the proton or the U quark from the antiproton and the D bar from the proton or vice versa. It's quite obvious that the most likely configuration is the one in which we take the up quark from the proton and the anti-D quark from the antiproton, because it's valence-valence, and therefore we have more of that. Likewise, if we want to produce a W minus, we take a D and a U bar. Now, it's intuitive, and it's proven by data, that the up quark distribution is larger than the down quark distribution inside the proton, simply because in the proton there are two up quarks and only one down quark. So in particular, if we go to large X, to quarks carrying a large fraction of the proton momentum, it's more likely that we find an up than that we find a down. And that means that in this collision, U D bar, the W plus is more likely going in the forward direction, I mean in direction of the proton, rather than in the direction of the antiproton. Okay? So if we look at the rapidity distribution, the longitudinal momentum distribution of the W plus, this is zero, this is rapidity, and it will more likely be something with that shape. Of course, PP bar is charge symmetric, so if we do this for the W minus, we get the symmetric distribution that will be something like that. So we see there is a slight asymmetry. So if we look at the differential distribution versus rapidity, this is proportional, there will be the matrix element, but then the PDF content will be the U quark content of a proton at x1, the d bar of the antiproton, plus, of course, there will be a contribution from the d bar in the proton and v up from the antiproton, and this, of course, is very small compared to that. We can do the same for the W minus. We have the U bar in the proton and the D in the antiproton, or the D in the proton and the U bar in the antiproton, which is the more likely situation. So we can take these. We can assume that we only have a valence contribution, so we neglect this and that, which is a very good approximation. And then we look at the difference divided by the sum. That is precisely what we define as being an asymmetry. And you can write out the expression for the symmetry just by using this. You can do it as an exercise. And this we can rewrite in terms of the difference between r calculated at x2 minus r calculated at x1, where this r is the ratio between the down and the up quark distribution as a function of x. So what we learn from here is that the asymmetry is actually created not really by the fact that the up quark is bigger than the down quark, but it's created by the fact that the ratio of the down quark divided by the U quark depends on x. Because you see, if the ratio of the down quark distribution and the up quark distribution were constant, let's say were exactly a factor of two, we have twice as many up as we have down, so down divided by up could be equal to one half, independently of x. If that were the case, then this ratio would be independent of x, and then when we take this difference, that would be exactly equal to zero. Okay? So observing an asymmetry different from zero means that the ratio between the up and the down quark distributions in x is not constant. Okay? And this is what, in fact, is observed experimentally. This is one example of the rapidity distribution of a W boson measured by the CDF experiment. You know the CDF experiment and the D0 experiments run at the Tevatron until about the beginning of the LHC, until 2008, I guess, starting from 1985. That was the very first collisions of the Tevatron, so more than 20 years of operations. So this is the rapidity of a W, and this is the charge asymmetry, which indeed is positive, as we would expect, because if we take the W plus minus the W minus, you see it's a positive asymmetry. It's more likely to produce W pluses in the forward region. This red line is the theoretical prediction based on a specific set of PDFs, and if one accounts for the fact that PDFs have some uncertainty, we discussed the uncertainty in the first lecture coming from the experimental data, the fitting procedure, etc., you see there is this blue band. And notice that this, this of course, is done at the time in which the measurement was taken, so we're probably talking about the second half of the 2000s, 2006, 2007, perhaps. And you see that this band is much broader than wider than the experimental uncertainty. Okay, you see here this point, the band is much larger than the experimental uncertainty. And that means that if we were to take these experimental data as input, as constraint for the PDFs, forcing the PDFs to reproduce within, say, one sigma of the experimental data would clearly reduce significantly the uncertainty on the PDF, would give rise to a much better set, much more precise set of PDFs, which then we can use in some other context. Of course, we cannot use those PDFs to predict this quantity any longer because we are just using it for the fit, right? But once we have the ratio D over U, that becomes relevant if we want to study, for example, the production of Z boson, in which a different combination of up and down appears. So it's intuitively obvious that the W plus will go forward and the W minus will go backward, and therefore there will be a positive asymmetry. But of course, we don't really see W bosons. What we see is the decay products, so leptons typically. And therefore, what we measure is something that's based on the rapidity distribution of the leptons. And something interesting happens here, because there is a competition between the asymmetry driven by the PDFs and the asymmetry that's induced by parity violation, by the fact that W decays, the W interactions violate parity. So let's look again in particular at the process. Let's consider the production of a W plus. As we said, this is dominated by a U quark scattering, annihilating an anti-down quark. So weak interactions are parity violating. It's only the left-handed states that contribute. So that means that the spin of the up quark has to point backward because this is the fermion. So it's a left-handed fermion and the right-handed anti-fermion. So this is the configuration of the spins. And that means that the W will have polarization pointing backward. As the W decays, if we really want to minimize the amount of angular momentum that we have to put into the system in order to have conservation of angular momentum, we would like to conserve the total angular momentum just by using the spins. We can do that by making sure that, you see, now we have a decay, so the particle going, having spin pointing in that direction will be moving in that direction. That has to be the anti-fermion, while the particle decaying in this direction will have a spin anti-aligned and therefore will have to be the fermion. If we have a W plus, the fermion is the neutrino because the W plus goes E plus neutrino. E plus is an anti-fermion, so it has to be right-handed. So in this decay, the neutrino tends to go forward and the positron tends to go backward. So you see now what the competition is. Because the W plus, sorry, and if we do for the W minus, it's exactly the opposite. The W minus, it's mostly produced by the quark coming from the proton. So again, we have exactly the same spin configuration for the final state, and the fermion has to go in the direction of the quark. Another way of looking at this is that it's the fermion line that tends to continue. Here, we don't have a flavor, right, because we go from quarks to leptons. So what we have to follow the fermionic line because gauge interactions conserve helicity, and therefore, if we have a given helicity state in the initial state, the fermion that will be passed on to the final state fermion. Now, in the case of a W minus, it's the electron which is the fermion, so it's the electron that goes forward and the antineutrino that goes backward. So the competition comes from the fact that, as we just saw, the W plus itself tends to go forward, while the W minus tends to go backward. But then when they decay, the decay product tends to go in the opposite direction. So the PDF pushes the W plus forward, while weak interactions, parity violation, sends the positron, so the final state lepton, backward. And that means that if we look at the asymmetry distribution, not of the W, which is always positive, but of the lepton, we get something that, you know, is will be a balance between these two competing effects. And this is, in fact, the rapidity. This is actually the pseudo-rapidity, but it's for leptons, it's exactly the same quantity. The pseudo-rapidity of leptons, this is the asymmetry, okay, in W decays. And this is zero. So you see that up to rapidity of the order of 2, indeed the asymmetry is positive, so the PDF effect wins. As we go more forward in rapidity, it's actually the V minus A, it's parity violation that wins. And the lepton, the positive lepton will tend to be less likely to go in the forward rapidity region than the negative lepton. And as an exercise, you just, you know, think about it. You just sit down and you try to understand why when we go to really very, very, very large rapidity at some point, it's unavoidable that parity violation should be the dominant effect. So we will always have a symmetry change sign when we go very, very forward. It's just a kinematical, effect, okay? Now, there are four plots because they correspond to presumably different ranges in ET, it's different cuts, and that shows that there is a kinematical dependence, but the message is all contained in just one of these plots. Okay? So this is a very cute example of an interplay between QCD and weak interactions. Now, in the case of a W, the structure of a weak interaction is very simple. It's very basic because it's strictly V minus A. So there is no parameter, right? There is nothing. If these were the Z boson decaying, then, of course, there is a competition between V minus A and V plus A, between vector and axial, but they don't come with a fixed coefficient, minus 1, but there is the sine square of a weak mixing angle in between, okay? So studying accurately the same asymmetry, charge asymmetry between the positron and the electron in final states where a Z is produced is an important probe of sine squared theta W, and this is exactly what was shown in Peskin's lecture yesterday. Of course, it's done with great precision in E plus E minus. That's where the best measurement of sine squared theta W come from the asymmetries from the distributions in Z decays. But asymptotically, with the great statistics that we have at the LHC, we will be able to approach that precision and hopefully one day match it and surpass it. Now, in PP collisions, things are slightly different. First of all, PP is not a charge symmetric initial state. If we take the charge conjugate, it becomes P bar, P bar. So things change. And in fact, in PP collision, it's not even true that the W plus cross section is equal to the W minus cross section. In PP bar, the probability of producing a W plus or a W minus must be exactly the same, right? Because it's just. While in PP, that is not the case. It's more likely the cross-section to produce a W plus is larger than the cross-section I'm producing a W minus. The rapidity distribution has to be symmetric. If we look at the individual W plus distribution, there is no way there can be an asymmetry in rapidity because given that it's PP, you know, we cannot tell what's left and what's right. So it will certainly be symmetric, the distribution. Here in this plot is shown, in fact, only the positive rapidity part. So this is the W plus distribution, but you should imagine that the negative part is exactly the reflection of this. And the W minus distribution is given here. And as you see, it's lower just because the integral of that distribution is the total W minus production cross-section, which is smaller than the W plus. This CS means the contribution coming from strange and charm initial states. So far, we just focused in the simplified equations that we wrote before. We focused on UD bar goes to W plus as a production channel. But of course, we could have also US bar. This would be proportional to the sine of the Khabibbo angle. So it's suppressed because of the Khabibbo angle, and it's suppressed because there is less strange than there is up quark. And we can have, of course, CD bar, which is doubly suppressed because there is the Khabibbo angle, which is small, and because the charm, there isn't much charm. And then there is CS bar as a possible contribution. Now, this is not Kabibbo suppressed, so the Kabibbo angle is almost one here, but we have a suppression because both the charm and the strange, of course, are smaller, have a smaller PDF than up and down. On the other hand, at the LHC, X starts becoming quite small for the production of a W because we have so much energy in the initial state. And therefore, there is enough room in Q squared for the evolution to allow both charm and S bar to grow. And in fact, the CS bar goes to W plus production rate is significant. It's about at 14 TV will be of the order of 30% of the total production rate. And we see it from this picture. So this is just the distribution. It's less peaked forward than the W plus because this forward peak is really due to the fact that to produce the W plus, we have a U quark against a D bar quark. And now the D bar quark is C, is not valence any longer, as was the case in PP bar. Okay, so there is really this significant asymmetry, if you wish, in the distribution. Okay, so we do have an asymmetry, okay, and this is really the absolute number of W pluses minus W minus is produced both in the forward and in the backward region, and this is the asymmetry that we get just by looking at the Ws. If we look at the decay products, again, we have the effect of parity violation, and again, that will tilt and modify the asymmetry. In fact, the asymmetry driven just entirely from the decay spectrum, leaving out the PDF effects, as you see, it goes into this direction. It's positive now. Sorry, this is the asymmetry for the lepton, the negative lepton over the positive lepton. There is a kinematical dependence as a function of a PT. These are details. And this is the experimental situation just as soon as the LHC started taking data, which means we have a data and we compare them with the predictions and the PDFs that were available at the time the LHC started. So PDFs that did not benefit in any way from the new LHC data. These early measurements, you see there are still rather large experimental uncertainties. Here it's mostly statistical. And these bands, the two plots are, again, because there are different sets of PDFs that are being used, you see there is a very, very broad range, okay, of predictions. So there is a lot of room to improve significantly our knowledge of PDFs by reducing the uncertainties on the measurements, and then tuning, fitting the PDFs. This has happened. These are the latest now data from run one, five inverse femtobars. As you see, the experimental measurement is much more precise now. Look at the uncertainties, the error bars, or the uncertainty bars are very, very small. And this is now the comparison against the data. There is one set here you see which is particularly outside, particularly in disagreement with the data. This is the so-called MSTW 2008. And what happened here, and this appears then in purple with a band that goes exactly, you don't even see it because it's almost completely overlapping with the data points, so it's brought inside. And what has happened to this PDF fit in going from here to something that agrees was very simple. Was not making use of new data, was not in particular using this data to improve the fit, was simply to modify the parameterization of the PDF itself. In other words, we start from an assumption of a functional form for, say, the D quark distribution would be 1 over x times 1 plus x square root of x plus log of x. One makes an assumption of a functional form to introduce few parameters, but then we'll go out and fit. And of course, once we freeze a functional form, the best that we can do is to fit those parameters. But if that functional form doesn't really agree very well with the data, there is no possible way we can improve it, right? if we try to fit a parabola with a straight line, you know, there is no way we can really do it very well. So what they did, they realized that there was an issue that previous data had not exposed. Previous data, other observables were not sensitive to this specific aspect of a parametrization. They moved to what is called a Chebyshev polynomial basis. That's what CP stands for here, CP deuteron. Deuteron is something else, it's not really relevant. So, and by passing to this new basis of a complete expansion, a complete set of polynomials that guarantees that you really can fit any function you want, automatically that drove the fit so as to agree very well with the current data. So these are just examples. Now, one big question, of course, which comes out of this is the following. I use a set of data, I use it to fix the PDFs. What if there were some new physics hidden inside those data? If the specific distribution here were driven by the fact that maybe there is some new particle that also decays leptonically, it could be, you know, production, for example, of a neutralino chargino in supersymmetry, the chargino decays leptonically to a neutralino plus plus a lepton, and the final state is lepton plus missing ET. So it looks exactly like the final state of a W. And, you know, if it comes with a sufficient rate, it can modify these distributions. So how do we know? I mean, is there a risk that by fitting PDFs, we're really washing away possible new physics, and we just parameterize new physics in the worst possible way, which is absorbing it in the PDF? And this is one of the big questions that everybody has to ask himself when they go out and play these games. So always caution has to be exercised in using data in order to fit PDFs. And I would like to take an example from the past history because it's pertinent, it's relevant to this discussion and has taught us a lot. And this is the kind of example that we will have to repeat in the future. So it all starts from an old paper by Professor Peskin and other colleagues who pointed out over 30 years ago that if quarks were not composite, there would be or leptons were not composite. Sorry, they were not fundamental. If they were composite, there were some underlying structure. Then this could be exposed by looking, of course, at very short distances inside the quarks. So this picture here is a picture of a scattering between a quark, which is now made out of three prions, three small components. Incidentally, this is a concept that Abu Salam worked on for many, many years and proposed for a long time, the ideas that even quarks might be composite objects and that one could have a prionic structure. So it's relevant to discuss this in this hall. So as we go to short distances, we can expose directly the interaction between these components. And one of the manifestations of this in the case of quarks would be a change in the Rutherford-like distribution of scattering. And in particular, if we go to very, very high energy, all of a sudden we would have an increase in the rate, for example, of jets produced at large PT. So this is the way the matrix, the cross-section, the partonic cross-section is modified. For UU bar goes to UU bar scattering. There is the QCD result, and then there is an interference term, and there is the square of the amplitude related to compositeness. Lambda is the scale at which quarks are composite, so it's a fixed number. And you see, since it's in the denominator, that means that the kinematical part will grow with energy square. So while the QCD part, as I said yesterday, it's dimensionless, so it doesn't matter what the energy is of a collision, here, this part, there is a 1 over lambda square, and therefore it grows like U squared divided by T, U squared divided by S. And that means that if I go to higher and higher energy, this term, the interference between the compositeness and QCD, grows relative to the QCD term itself. Okay, so this stays constant as we go to high energy, while this grows linearly with the energy square for scattering at, say, 90 degrees. And this is what happens. So this line, this is for a collider at 10 TeV. These are the days in which one was planning the VSSC. For a collider at 10 TeV, this is the spectrum in transverse energy of jets that we get from QCD. And if we have a compositeness K lambda of 5 TeV, 7.5 TeV, 10 TeV, etc., this is the way the spectrum would be deformed. And as you see, we're talking about corrections which are not 10-20%, are corrections that could be very, very large, factors of 2 or even 10. So we've been saying since 83 for many, many years, let's look at the high detail of jet spectrum, because if we see a discrepancy, that's a sign that quarks are composite. So 12 years later, a paper comes out from CDF at the Tevatron, in which exactly this quantity has been measured. These are the data points. The solid line was the best theoretical prediction at the time, based on next to leading order QCD, so already in the era of QCD precision in colliders. And if we look more closely at this tail, we see that there is exactly this departure from the expected behavior, the departure that is foreseen by compositeness. This different line, so this is the ratio between the data and the theory, right? Minus one, so it should be exactly zero. These different curves correspond to playing around with all of the PDS that were available at the time. So there is certainly some plus or minus 10-15% uncertainty, but nevertheless, nothing really gives rise to this shape. So if one had to stick to what had always been said, this was the discovery of compositeness. But of course, people started thinking a bit more carefully. They said, you know, how well do we really know the PDFs, right? Here we're talking about jets at 400, 450 GeV. The Tevatron had beams with energy of 900 GeV, 900 over 900 was 1.8 TeV. So here we're talking about quarks or gluons carrying 50% of a proton energy, x equal to 0.5. So it's a very large value of x, in which experimentally, of course, there were very, very few data, because it's very rare to find these quarks carrying all of this energy, so the data are poor. And therefore, people started thinking about how do we convince ourselves that we understand PDFs at those values. Well, one could have said, okay, fine. We have to admit that this is an effect of PDFs. We take this data and we fit and tune the PDFs. But by doing that, of course, you preempt your possible discovery of compositeness. So it's really a dilemma. Now, the solution to this problem comes by looking a bit more closely at the kinematics of jet production. And we discussed yesterday what the kinematics is. This is the beam line, and I said we have three parameters. One is the PT of a jet, and then we have the rapidity, the angle, emission angle of one jet, and the emission angle of the other jet. So this is the longitudinal, this is the proton and the antiproton, right? So they don't have to be exactly, they have to be back-to-back in the transverse plane so that PT is exactly the same, but then they can have different angles because the initial state can be boosted. So we're interested in x large. And of course, if we take a collision at 90 degrees at very, very high energy, we have indeed x large. That's where those jet data were coming from. If both jets are central, both axes will be large. But there is another way in which we can generate configurations that probe a very large x, and that is to consider that not both initial state quarks to have large x, but just one. So we have a very fast moving quark scattering against a very slow quark. So this is x very large, say of order 0.5. This is x, say, of order 0.01. So what we're creating in this way is a system that has an invariant mass which is relatively small, because the total amount of energy here is small because there isn't much energy coming from here. So when we're looking at a collision with a small total energy, it means that we're probing a system with a mass of maybe 100 GeV, 200 GeV. And we know that 200 GeV, there is no new physics because we already explored the region of the 200 GeV. We know that at the scale of 200 GeV, quarks are not composite, for example. And that means that we are working in a situation in which the standard model has been fully tested and we can be guaranteed that there is no new physics. So what we're looking at now is just the outcome of a collision of this initial state. And that will be two jets, of course, of relatively of moderate PT, but highly boosted in the forward region. So if we go out and we do the measurement of two jets going in the forward region, we know that we can rely on QCD, and we will use that as a way of probing the X distribution at large X. In this slide, there are a couple of equations which control somehow the kinematics, and you can look at them and study them in this context. So what people did, they then just did the analysis of a PT spectrum, not for centrally produced jets, but for jets produced at larger and larger rapidities. And this is what we see here. These are D0 jet data plotted as a function of rapidity, and you see it goes down to rapidity between 2 and 2.5. That corresponds to a few degrees. So it's really jet going very, very forward. And in fact, you see that the spectrum falls dramatically, right? And out here, even though it's a PT of only, say, 200 GeV, we are really probing X in the range of 0.5, 0.6. So we use this data now to do the fits of the PDFs. And when we redo the fit of the PDFs using this data and we plug it back into the data in the central region, we get something which is now in much better agreement with the data themselves. And these are the final results from the Tevatron on the jet spectra. And as you see, again, this is the ratio between data and theory. So this should be equal to 1. Yellow is the current uncertainties on. So this is the experimental uncertainty. These red lines are the PDF uncertainties. And you see that all of the data are perfectly consistent with the PDF and experimental uncertainty. So there is no indication of compositeness. So this should really be the example of how in the future we will have to use data to tune and fit PDFs. Now, a few selected results on jet physics from VLHC. Here for you to look at afterwards is a breakdown of all of the possible channels. Here we have quark-quark. When I say elastic scattering, quark-quark elastic scattering, what I mean is literally gluon exchange in the T-channel, okay? So it's elastic, not in the sense of proton-proton elastic collision, but in the sense that there is a simple exchange of, it's not an annihilation process, it's really the exchange of a gluon in the T-channel. And that is by far the dominant process when we are looking at very high ETs, right? So this plot starts from about 1 TeV, and we see that it is already dominant. Now, this dotted line is all QQ is quark gluon. So you see the quark gluon, the contribution with the gluon is always very important, and it becomes the most important. The solid line here is the total. So down here, up to about, 1 TeV, the most dominant process is quark gluon. If we were to go to even smaller ETs, we would see glu as being the dominant one. It's this one that's shooting up. If we go down to about 100 GeV, as I said yesterday, that is the dominant process. But as we go to very, very high ET, it's a quark-quark valence-valence scattering that dominates. And this is a comparison between data. These are relatively recent data. It's an analysis completed last year of the data collected in 2011. As you see already now, today, from the experience of the Tevatron, data are always plotted as a function of rapidity. So there are data in the central rapidity region that go up to about 2 TeV, transverse momentum, and these are the most forward data from the region between 2.5 and 3 in rapidity. This is really very, very short angle. Now, these distributions are scaled so that one can look at them. by different factors. So you see the data are multiplied by 10 to the minus 3, 10 to the minus 6, 10 to the minus 9, so that they get really separated. Once you correct for these and you look at the actual range in cross sections that is brought by these measurements, you will find that there is 10 orders of magnitude. Okay? So from the most frequent jets that are being measured to the rarest jets of the highest energy, there is a factor of 10 billion in rate. Okay? And the solid lines that go through, and these points that we see correspond to the theoretical, a theoretical calculation from first principles with convoluted with the PDFs known at the time. And as you see in a log scale, there is perfect agreement. Here again is for different energies, 7, 8, and 14 TeV. This is the fractional contribution from different channels, so quark gluon, glu-glu, and QQ and QQ prime scattering. And again, as I said before, above about 1500, 2000 GeV, quark-quark scattering becomes the dominant one. One thing which is important is that now these measurements are becoming very accurate at the level of 10%. The theory is accurate from the QCD perspective also at that level. So we could start doing measurement fits of PDFs at the 10%, 5% level. And then that's a stage at which one has to stop and ask whether indeed all of the possible effects are being taken into account. Weak interactions typically play a minor role in QCD physics because the weak coupling is weak. But nevertheless, it's not so much weaker, right? After all, alpha S is of order 10%. Alpha weak, it's only a factor of a few smaller than that. So at the level of few percent, it should be obvious that electroweak corrections play a role. And this is a plot that shows the impact of electroweak corrections. If you do the calculation of a jet rate, including or not including electroweak corrections, which means exchanges of W bosons, for example, instead of exchanging gluons, what we see is that already at 1 TeV, we get about, it's a 5% correction, and at 2 TeV, it's a 12% correction. 2 TeV is the range where already data are exploring things. Once we go to 13 TeV this year, we will be going up to about 4 TeV. And as we see, 10, 15%, this is the effect of a quark gluon contribution. See, quark gluon at a couple of TeV is about 15%. That means that if we want to hope to extract the gluon PDF by looking at large X, by looking at the jet data, there is no way we can do it without incorporating electroweak corrections as well, because electroweak corrections are as large as the quark gluon contribution, right? And if we want to control the quark gluon, we have to include that. These are other plots in which there are discussions, comparisons between systematics coming from different experimental effects and theory, so I can skip that. Okay, so this is, so far we were talking about typically diejet final states. Once we produce diejets, as we saw yesterday in the case of the plus E minus goes to QQ bar, 10% alpha S percent of the times, we get extra hard radiation. There is a third jet. We saw that yesterday in one of the pictures. And in PP collisions, of course, that's the case as well. And in fact, not only the third jet, but we also have a fourth jet, a fifth jet, a sixth jet. We have so much energy available that the probability of emitting radiation is very large, and the probability of emitting extra jets is also enhanced. In fact, it's enhanced by much more than just alpha S, because the moment we have an extra particle produced, we have so much energy that there is an immense amount of phase space that's available. And the integration of this phase space contributes to additional log factors that enhance the rate. So these are plots that document the analysis, one of the early analyses from ATLAS. And what we see up here on the top left is the inclusive jet multiplicity. That means that they look at final states with jets, they reconstruct jets, they count the number of jets, and they plot the rate. And these are jets with energy. There is no threshold here. I believe it's like 60 GeV, if I remember correctly, the minimum PT of a jet. Yeah, it starts at 60 GeV. And we see that we have rate here all the way up to six jets. In fact, it continues all the way up to 10, 11 with the data we have today. And this is compared against theoretical calculations. The yellow band is the systematic uncertainty of the experiment and statistical uncertainty. And the scale is, you see it, right? We're talking about an agreement at the level of plus or minus 20%. So we can describe processes with six jets in the final state with an agreement between data and calculations at the level of 20%. If you want to calculate at leading order, forget about next leading order, at leading order, a six-jet final state, it means glue goes to six gluons. And I cannot remember the exact number, but the number of Feynman diagrams is in the range of a million. So you have to sit down and calculate over a million very complicated Feynman diagrams, because each Feynman diagram is two gluons going to six gluons. The number of terms, if you expand it, is immense, and you multiply that by 1 million, and that's just the matrix element. You have to take the square with all of the interferences, right? So these things can be done nowadays in a almost routine way, thanks to developments, advances over the past 20 years. And in fact, they can be done even at next to leading order. Once you do the leading order exercise, it's peanuts compared to what it means to promote everything to next to leading order. And again, the techniques allow that to be done. So this is, in principle, a topic of discussion and of not just one, but of a whole series of lectures, something that I will not discuss at all. But which is rather well documented in the literature, and it is one of the most interesting fields of development in collider physics nowadays. So it's not just the rates that, you know, we get right. You can experimentally explore the distributions, the energy distribution of the leading jet, of the second leading jet, the third, up to the fourth, and you can go beyond. At some point, the statistics, of course, will hit you. And even for the fourth leading jet, you see it's not just the total rate, but really the spectrum is in perfect agreement with the calculations. Okay? Now, here is a few considerations, because, you know, typically we say you emit an extra jet, that costs alpha s, so the probability to have an extra jet is more or less 10% than having one jet less. And the question is that correct? I mean, to which extent this is a meaningful statement, and to which extent we can use these rules of thumb to estimate rates for complicated multi-jet final states. So I have a couple of slides with some considerations here. What is plotted here, and the conclusion of this exercise will be to convince you that one has to be extremely careful in using these rules of thumb. It's true that higher order corrections are of order alpha s, but unless we define very carefully what is the observable, we can be making serious mistakes in our projections, okay? So we have to start by defining clearly what is our observable. Here, my observable is a final state with a given number of jets, 2, 3, 4, 5, in which each jet has a minimum transverse energy, 20, 50, 100. Okay, so the final state is defined by the jet multiplicity, jets above a given threshold. And now I look at the rate, and I do it for 2 jets, 3 jets, 4 jets, up to 5 jets. These are numbers that come from a theoretical calculation. Okay, these are not data. This is just one of those calculations I was mentioning before. And here the ratios of 3 jets over 2 jets, 4 over 3, 5 over 4. And as you see, the ballpark of these rates is indeed, say, about 10%. In the case of 4 over 3, it's about, 7%, 10%, 13%, depending on the threshold. The higher is the jet threshold, the more it costs to emit an extra jet. It's rather obvious, right? Because we want to have a harder emission So this is reflected in these slopes. And on average, for a jet of, say, 50 GeV, adding an extra jet takes, indeed, something of the order of alpha S. It's interesting that if we look at the ratio of 3 to 2 relative to 4 to 3, it seems that it costs much more to emit the third jet than to emit the fourth jet. Okay? And you may think that it's a bit strange, because if you have two jets, you only emit one. If you have three jets and you want to emit a fourth one, God, you know, you already asked me to emit a third jet, now you ask me to emit also a fourth one, that should be even more expensive. Well, it turns out that it's not, because it's only 3% of a diejet events above 50 GV, it's only 3%, 4% that has the extra jet, while it's 10% of events with three jets that have a fourth jet. And what is the explanation for this? Again, it's not alpha S, it's purely kinematics. Because if we take a two-jet event with two jets above a given threshold, say 50 GV, we have a jet here and we have a jet there, and that is 50 GV each. Now, if we want to have a third jet, it will also have to be above 50 GV. It has to go someplace. So we have to add another 50 GV. So the minimum amount of energy that this is costing us is at least increasing by 50% the energy required. Because even if there is no longitudinal momentum, the two jets go back to back, 50-50, that makes 100 GV. If we want to have three jets, they have to be at least 150, right? And I can put them as a Mercedes-like, I can put them like this, 50-50-50. In the transverse plane. Now, this is the beam line. Okay, that's the way to minimize the energy. So the minimum energy configuration is 150 versus 100. So it's 50% more energy. If I have three jets above 50 and I want to add the fourth jet, I only add 50 more. And now it's 50 divided by 150. That's what I'm adding. So I'm only adding 30% of the energy. Already I had to put a lot of energy into creating three jets, and now to add the fourth one, it's only a 30% increase, while for two jets going to three, it's a 50% increase, okay? And that's why the more jets I have, the less it will cost me to add the extra one. I have to pay a lot to get to have many jets, but once I have them, I can add the extra one with a smaller and smaller cost. Up to the point where I'm really saturating phase space. Of course, if I am already using all of the energy I have available in the proton-proton collision, there is no more energy left for the extra one, and there I start paying, okay? So these are the considerations behind this table. And now we go to a completely different final state, and now we define the final state not by the number of jets and their threshold, but by the total amount, by the very mass of a system. So now we're looking at a multi-jet system with a total invariant mass in the partonic system above, say, 100 GV, 500 GV, 1,000 GV. So what I'm doing here, I'm asking the question, what's the distribution in jet multiplicity of a final state in which I have, say, a glue-glue collision going to gluons and jets with square root of S hat equal larger than some number, 100, 500, 1,000. And with this constraint, I go and I calculate what's the rate of 2, 3, 4, etc. jets. So let's look at, and now I have defined my jets. My jets are above 20 GV, but I'm not varying the jet ET threshold. I'm just varying the total energy. So this is these are the rates as a function of 2, 3, 4 of jet multiplicity. You see that in the case of a 100 GV threshold, it's much more likely to have two jets than to have 3, 4, or 5 jets in the final state. Okay? So indeed, the two-jet configuration is dominant. If I go to 500 GV, we see that now it's the three-jet configuration which is dominant. In other words, if I put 500 GeV into my system, I'm more likely to come out with three jets than with two jets. And in fact, even three jets, four jets, are more likely than two jets. And if I inject now 1 TeV in my system, you see that two jets are peanuts, so I pretty much never find two jets. I'm much more likely to find five or four or free. Okay? So if we inject all of this energy, you know, the leading process is indeed the 2-2-2 scattering, if you wish, but there is so much acceleration because I have so much energy that nothing prevents this quark from or gluons from radiating. And they're radiating off radiation with great probability, and that radiation being emitted itself will form jets. Okay? So as you see, we get a completely different picture in the structure of a final state if we look at it using this observable. Okay? So it's not true that two jets are more likely than three, than four, than five, etc. It depends on what you ask of a final state. Yes, question. So these are below. Why are they below? They are below because I believe I put that line in the wrong place. It's just, this is an old version of Keynote that I imported the slide from before, and occasionally there are glitches like that. So it is not physics. In fact, I was looking at it and I said, what the hell is going on? But any more questions or deep doubts? Is this clear? It's clear why it's important? It's important, right? Because often, you know, in many branches of high energy physics, there are things that one can do on a, you know, the classic back of the envelope, right? In plus and minus, there are many things that can be done because at least the initial state is under control. In you know, some B physics, in decays, one can, you know, do a matrix element, one can calculate the kinematics. Things are much, you know, systems are much more constrained, and it's there are many opportunities to get estimates as out of a back of the envelope calculation. In Hadron Collider physics, everything is much harder, right? Because everything, you have to go through the PDFs that you know you don't have in your head. Everything is a computer code. So, but occasionally there are things that one can control analytically. The example of a charm PDF we did in the first lecture is one. And then everything else, one has to develop some sense of you know, experience, right? It's like culinary art. It's like cooking, right? You can read everything about how much salt you have to put and this and that, how long you should cook, but it's only by doing it for a long time that then you develop this sense. So it's important to look at the numerical results, trying to put them in perspective and learn the skill of predicting what will happen in a given situation. If I put a given set of cuts, how will that impact? And maybe you can get counterintuitive results, such as three or four jets having higher rates than two jets for very solid reasons, right? I mean, the reasons here are very simple, but you have to think about it at least once. Okay. Now, yes, question. You should repeat the question in the microphone because I couldn't hear.
Does the energy determine whether your jets are collimated, or is it only a function of the kinematics of your system?
Of course, yes. The question is whether it's just the invariant mass that counts, or also the way we define the jets, and if there is some minimal separation, for instance. Everything counts. Of course, this specific number here, it's not written, and you're right, I should have written it. There is an assumption on what is the cone, for example, that defines the jet, and there is an assumption on how collinear the jets can be. If I allowed the jets to be very, very, very close, to the point that, to me, individual particles are jets, then, of course, the jet multiplicity would be huge because it would be the multiplicity, right? Here, the jets are quite separated. It's probably 0.7 in this delta R separation. So they are about, say, you know, 40 degrees from each other, at least, separation in space. And of course, if one were to separate them more, then needless to say, these numbers would change. But the picture is more or less qualitatively remains the same. Okay? So these were global properties of a jet. So we look at the jet as if it's a single entity. Oh, I'm sorry.
In previous slide, like two slides back, another. Yeah. In 50 GV, why it is harder to produce fifth jet than fourth jet? I mean, there's 10% and there's 90%, and with our considerations, it was easier.
Well, there are two reasons. One is that at this level, it could just be, you know, the statistics of the calculation, right? So 0.9 and 0.09 and 0.1, plus or minus the uncertainty of the calculation is the same. But you see, it's exactly the same here, 0.13, 0.13, 0.71, 0.67, it's slightly larger. I think that the reason here is simply that we start hitting phase space, because now we are asking five jets above 50 GV. So at that point, we really run into the fact that PDFs go down. So we cannot arbitrarily add. At some point, this increase has to stop, because once we put so much energy in the system that there is no energy available, we pay a lot of penalty to have the extra jet, right? So it's kind of a turnover, and this is probably the crossover point. But I think that this is really more like, I should have maybe calculated the numbers more precisely, so that this ratio were really that plus or minus one per mil. I think that it's like 10%, the uncertainty on that. Okay, so as I said, those were jets treated as single objects. We just look at the energy of this cluster of particles. What is very interesting is what happens inside the jet. We discussed this somehow yesterday as well. We want to know how many particles there are inside. What are these particles? What is the momentum distribution? When we talk about the energy of a jet, we don't care whether that energy is carried mostly by a couple of particles or whether it's equally distributed among them. And this has a crucial impact on two things. On one side, experimentally, if we have one pion of 10 GV or 10 pions of 1 GV, the experiment measures a different quantity, okay, because they interact with the detector in a way which is not exactly linear. So the way we translate the measurement of a calorimeter into a total energy depends on whether it's 10 pions carrying 1 GV or 1 pion carrying 10 GV. The other point is that the features of the way the jet develops depend on the nature of a jet. If it's a gluon jet, the gluon has more charge, it will radiate more, so there will tend to be more particles inside the jet than if it were a quark jet. And a quark jet, say a B jet, has different features than an up quark jet, because the B jet contains the B meson, the B meson decays, has a lifetime, as we saw yesterday in Michael Peskin's lecture. All of these features of what happens inside the jet are crucial to give crucial information. So the first thing to ask ourselves after we analyze the global properties, inclusive properties of jets, is whether we understand more exclusive properties of jets, what's inside. And this we do to start with by looking at what is called the jet fragmentation function. The jet fragmentation function is the distribution dn by dz, where n is the number of tracks inside the jet, and z is the momentum parallel to the direction of the jet carried by a given track relative to the jet energy or transverse energy. Okay? So we look at the various parts, we measure the jet energy, we look at the various particles, their momentum, and the fraction of the jet energy carried by a particle is the variable z, and we plot the n by dz. It's a bit like the PDFs. We're looking at the number of quarks carrying 10% of the proto momentum, that's the PDF. The number of particles carrying 10% or some percent of the jet energy is the fragmentation function. And these are data compared against. So this is done for jets of different energy. Higher energy jets, of course, are more accelerated, so they radiate more. radiating more, that we have a higher multiplicity, but having higher multiplicity means that individual particles will be carrying smaller amount of energy. Okay? If I have a high energy jet, instead of the multiplicity as a function of a jet, the jet ET, the multiplicity will go approximately logarithmically divided by some scale. That's the multiplicity, right? The average number of charge tracks in a jet. It grows logarithmically because logarithmic is the probability of emitting gluons. So as we go to higher ET, there will be more particles. More particles will have to share the given amount of energy. So the average momentum fraction carried by each individual particle will be smaller. They will have higher energy, but Z, on average, will be softer. And that's why we study this distribution as a function of the PT of a jet. And if you were to look more carefully, because this is a very compressed log scale, you would indeed find the effect of scaling violation, which is given by that logarithmic dependence. And this is the comparison between the data and the calculations. These are the different color points correspond to simulations obtained using different Monte Carlos, Pythia, Herwig, Sherpa. And as you see, again, within perhaps 20%, there is a very good agreement. You can also say that within 20%, there are discrepancies, given that the data are very accurate, and that means that this is a very useful observable to improve even more the Monte Carlo simulation. So different shower, parton shower Monte Carlos give different predictions because there are slightly different ways to approach, for example, hadronization in the final stage, and they reflect themselves in different predictions, which at the level of plus or minus 20% can be improved. The other thing that is of interest is to look at the mass of the jet itself. The jet is born as a single quark, okay? And the mass of a single quark or of a gluon is equal to zero, or lambda QCD if you wish, but it's a small number. On the other hand, as soon as the quark is produced and radiated by being accelerated, it radiates. Radiates, it evolves, and at the end of the day, we get all of our pions. Okay, so the final state hadrons. If we look at the invariant mass now, at this system, so we do the sum of the momenta of all of the particles inside the jet squared, this is what we define as the mass of a jet squared. And this number is obviously greater than zero, right? So it's born as a quark. At the end of the day, it gets a mass, and of course, it's because somehow it's quantum mechanics, right? The final state... The mass is not something that gets preserved in the course of the evolution. So it's of interest to, because it's a probe of how well we describe the evolution of a jet, to plot the invariant mass of a jet, again, as a function of a jet ET. And these are different distribution of a jet mass as a function of jet ETs, I believe, again, compared against the data. And the agreement is excellent. The one place where this is of interest is when we go and we look at very high energy jets, and we ask ourselves, how do I know, is there any way that I can use the information on the structure of this jet to learn about what was the origin of a jet? Because I drew this for a quark, but how do I know, if I just look at the final state partons, but everything started from a quark, or maybe it started from a gluon, or maybe it started from something even more exotic. It could have been a top quark, for example. A top quark, of course, which is very slow, decays to a W and a B. So it's a very clearly reconstructable object as being a top. But if this top is boosted to very, very high momentum, of course it decays to a W, it decays to a B, which are almost collinear. The W decays to a QQ bar pair. And at the end, if it's very much boosted, everything ends up being inside the same jet. So it's only by looking inside that I can learn something about the origin. And one of the things that I need to know is really how the mass distribution of all of the particles inside the jet behaves. And this is an example of a recent measurement, you see 2014 from ATLAS, in which they studied configurations of, you know, two jets, or say a W recoiling against jets, relatively fat jets at high energy. They go and they reconstruct the mass of a jet, and if it were only QCD jets, there would be a given shape, which is this. And you see there is a little bump here relative to what the expectation is. And this bump corresponds to an invariant mass in the range of 80 plus or minus 20 GeV. And what that is indeed a contamination coming from Ws being produced at large PT, Ws that decay to QQ bar. So when we look at the jet and we just see hadrons with a given energy, and you know, we know nothing of where it came from. If we look at the invariant mass of the system, indeed, in principle, we can reconstruct some excess that corresponds to the production of a W. So this is the observation of a W decaying to jets, something that experimentally is very hard to detect in a hadron collider by using these tools. And this is the boosted jets techniques that Michael Peskin was mentioning yesterday. Okay. One can use these observables to go back the jet spectra, angular correlations, and again ask the question: do I see a possible substructure of quarks, or are quarks still point-like? Typically, what one plots is angular distributions expressed as a function of this variable chi. It's a strange variable. It's 1 plus the cosine of a scattering angle divided by 1 minus the cosine of a scattering angle. As an exercise, it's a trivial one. Just prove that this d chi, this distribution, is nothing but d cos theta divided by sine to the fourth theta divided by 2. Now, why is sine to the fourth theta divided by 2 interesting? What is it that goes like 1 divided by sine to the fourth theta divided by 2? Shout. What's the distribution? What does 1 over sine to the fourth theta divided by 2 remind you of? Rutherford, very good, exactly. So Rutherford is the exchange of a photon, of course, but if we have the exchange of a gluon, it's still exactly the same. Nothing changes because it's a spin one particle, it's a gauge interaction. So quark-quark scattering is dominated by single gluon exchange, so it has to obey the Rutherford distribution. And if we plot dn by d eta, we should be getting something that, if it's just Rutherford, would be entirely flat. And these distributions done for diejet final states of different diejet invariant mass are pretty much flat on the scale that we see here. There is slight deviations from being flat, which are due to the acceptance of a detector, the fact that it's not only T-channel exchange, there is also contamination from gluon fusion, S-channel, U-channel, of course. But when we compare the data against the expectation of the exact QCD calculation, there is perfect agreement. And the conclusion is that up to the scale of 1 divided by 10 TeV, quarks still behave as elementary objects. There is no evidence of compositeness. So I have now a set of slides dedicated to the physics of a top quark. Let me just start. I doubt I will be able to finish it, and then we can start tomorrow. This is endless. The lecture I have today is a gazillion slides, and I don't have to go through all of it. So top quark production. The dominant production modes are glue-glue fusion. There is also a contribution coming from quark-anti-quark in VS channel. This is typically at the proton-proton collider, this is typically small. And what we see here is for VLHC of a different LHC energy, 7, 8, and 14 TV, this is the fraction of a TT-bar production rate that comes from glue-glue collisions as a function of the invariant mass of a TT-bar pair. So we're looking at TT-bar final state, we're looking at TT production at threshold, but also at very high invariant mass, which is interesting because, you know, one is exploring maybe resonances, exotic objects decaying to TT-bar. And what is displayed here is the fact that up to very large TT-bar invariant masses, we're still dominated at the level of, say, 90% by glue-glue initial state. So even though, as we go to very large X, the gluon becomes smaller and smaller relative to the quarks, still glue-glue initial state dominates TT-bar production all the way up to very, very large X. And the reason for that, contrary to the jets, right? With jets, we saw at 100 GeV, it's mostly glue-glue goes to glue-glue, but as soon as we are above 1 TV or 2 TV, it's all quark-quark. Well, the key difference is that here, the alternative to glue-glue production of TT-bar, the alternative is quark-anti-quark. But the anti-quark, there is much less anti-quark inside the proton than there is gluons, okay? Because the anti-quark comes from the gluon splitting. So we have the anti-quark is alpha S times the gluon, okay? So glue-glue still is a winner over QQ-bar. In addition, there are other dynamical enhancements. QQ-bar goes through the S channel, so the cross-section goes like 1 divided by the mass square of a TT-bar pair, while glue-glue, there is a T-channel exchange. So the cross-section does not go like 1 over the mass of a TT-bar pair square. The cross-section goes like 1 divided by the mass of a top quark square, and it's a fixed number, okay? The dimensions are given by the mass of the top. So the cross sections, the corrections due to being at large mass affect higher order terms. So these are important ingredients. This incidentally means, just because the gluon is so important, that we can use the TT-bar cross section measured in a very precise calculation of the TT-bar cross section in order to extract information on the gluon density, okay? Again, assuming that there is no new physics entering in TT-bar production, which has to be verified. This gives you a picture of how accurately we can calculate the TT-bar cross-section. This is the cross-section at 8 TV, at leading order, at next to leading order in QCD, at next to leading order. So you see the precision, the rate grows slightly as we go, as we add more terms, but the precision increases dramatically. These red and blue lines correspond to refinements of the fixed order calculation that come from the resummation of soft gluons. It's theoretical refinements that, as you see, improve slightly the accuracy. So right now, down here, we are at a level of plus or minus 3% coming from the missing, you know, the not knowing higher order corrections beyond next to leading order. There is a PDF uncertainty, which is also at the level of 2 to 3%. And then there is some parametric uncertainties, the value of alpha S, the value of the top mass, of course, we don't know. Exactly, and that leads to some uncertainties. But, you know, overall it means that theoretically we control the TT-bar cross-section to the level of perhaps 4 or 5%, which is comparable to the experimental. Well, experimentally we can do even better. Now, one of the important things about the top is its mass in relation to the W mass. That was also explained yesterday, because they enter in all of these precise precision tests of the electroweak sector. Okay, those oblique parameters that were discussed yesterday, STU, you remember they were driven by the value of a top mass, which appear quadratically in several places, and the value of the Higgs mass, but through the electroweak symmetry breaking, the W mass is a key player in that test as well. Now, in fact, the Higgs mass is known much, much more accurately than we know, for example, the top quark, and the leading uncertainties arise indeed from the W and the top mass. So to improve the measurement of the top mass is very important. For what concerns the W mass, I just want to point out the measurement was partly illustrated yesterday in Peskin's lecture. One thing that is worth noting is that, say, at the Tevatron, but the same is true at the LHC, the dominant source of systematics today, this is, for example, for CDF, this is a list of all of the systematics, and the single largest systematics is from parton distributions, is the knowledge of the PDFs. Okay? And the reason is that the observable that is typically used is this transverse mass of a W. That has this Jacobian peak. And the extraction of information on the mass comes from a global fit of this distribution. So it's not just the position of a peak that counts, but it's the global shape. And down here, the region of low transverse mass is the one dominated by low PT leptons. Low PT because maybe the W has decayed with an angle. So the invariant mass of a lepton plus neutrino system is always the W mass. If the W decays at 90 degrees, the lepton has PT equals to the W mass divided by 2. But if the decay, of course, is tilted, then the transverse momentum will be smaller. Okay, so the region of small transverse momentum corresponds to the region of small PT. That means forward emission, and the experiments cannot measure all the way down to angle equals to zero. They only measure in the central region. So the details of the rapidity distribution of a lepton of a given PT are important in order to do the fit of this distribution. But the rapidity distribution of a lepton, as we saw at the very beginning of the lecture, is driven by the PDFs. So information on how the W is boosted back and forth is crucial in order to do a proper fit of a W mass, and that's why there is an important systematics that is left there. And this systematics is pretty much the same at the level of plus or minus 10 MeV at the LHC. So I think I will just give you one final remark, and then I stop here. We discussed the precision of a top quark, and I said the mass of a top quark is an uncertainty in predicting the top cross-section. And therefore, we can turn it around. We can say if we had a very precise estimate of a top cross-section, we can use it to pull out the top mass. Now, and this is an idea that's being put forward by several people in these days. I just want to point out that the dependence of a cross-section on the mass, which is given here, d sigma over sigma, is about 5 times delta m over m, or vice versa, implies that if we want to have a 1% measurement of a mass, we need to control the cross-section to a 5% level. And 5% is pretty much the accuracy that we have today. So if we have a 5% systematics, we get a 1% determination of a top mass, but 1% of 175 GV is about 2 GV. This slide is old, at a time when 2 GV was the direct measurement of a top mass. Now the mass of a top is known to about 0.7 GV, say of the order of 1 GV. So in order to improve on that, in order to push the top mass precision below 1 GV, we would need a measurement of a cross-section with a total uncertainty, including the experimental systematics and the theoretical systematics, which is better than 2.5%. And that's something that's very, very, very hard to imagine we will be able to achieve. We can possibly go down to, say, 2%, But that again will only be 1 GV. So if we really want to push the knowledge, the measurement of a top mass to a precision of the order of a few hundred MeVs, this is not really a good way of doing that, and we do have to measure it directly, something that can be done at any plus and minus collider operating at the T-bar threshold, something that in principle can be done in hadron collisions. It's very complicated for reasons that I can maybe illustrate tomorrow. I can start tomorrow's lectures discussing this because it's a rather interesting topic. So I stop it here now.